My name is Michael Carilli, and in this talk, I'll tell you about CUDA Graph support in PyTorch, a new feature that improves performance by greatly reducing CPU overhead. First, we'll cover the basic concepts, performance benefits, and limitations. Then we'll go over examples of the new PyTorch API. A CUDA Graph is a static record of GPU work, meaning kernels, kernel arguments, and kernel execution dependencies. The entire record of work can be replayed with a single CUDA API call. Graphs help because they greatly reduce CPU overhead for static workloads. During ordinary eager execution, each op incurs CPU overhead from Python, the PyTorch backend, and the CUDA driver. It's moderate, but it adds up. As GPU throughput increases relative to CPUs, we often see eager execution bound by CPU overhead. On the left is such a GPU timeline. The GPU runs each kernel faster than the CPU can feed it, and utilization is poor. But for network regions whose shapes and ops don't change across iterations, most of the CPU overhead is redundant. We don't need to rerun all the CPU work to compute shapes and launch individual kernels every time. We can record a CUDA graph of a single dummy iteration, then replay the graph in the training loop, which removes all that CPU work from the critical path. On the right, you see the GPU timeline for the same ops launched as a graph replay, and it's nicely packed. Here's a detailed example showing CPU and GPU timelines for a full CPU-limited eager iteration and an equivalent graphed iteration. Again, it's clear the graph replay has much less CPU overhead and a much denser GPU timeline. The pictures are not to scale. The graphed version ran 4x faster overall. Graphs also reduce jitter in distributed training. Jitter is a common cause of poor scaling efficiency because collective operations like all reduces need to wait for the slowest rank. CPU overhead is a common source of jitter. CPUs are more sensitive to sources of performance non-determinism like OS scheduling, lock contention, and competition with data loading and augmentation. The left picture shows two GPU timelines of different ranks for a CPU-bound network. The timelines are not well aligned. Rank 1 runs ahead. Its all-reduce begins first and must spin, waiting for rank 0's all-reduce. By removing CPU overhead from the critical path, graphs reduce jitter. The right picture shows GPU timelines of two ranks using graph replay. You can see they're much better aligned. Here's a detailed example showing the end of a backward pass and an optimizer step. Each pair of timelines shows the GPU work on two different ranks in the same job. In the graphed case, not only are the timelines denser, but relative jitter is reduced. Again, these are not to scale. The graphed version was much faster overall. Here are some speedups we achieved with graphs for real networks. 1.1x on BERT at our max scale for the MLPerf 1.0 submission. 1.6x on Mascar CNN, again at our MLPerf max scale. 2.2x on DLRM, as presented in our deep learning examples. 1.1 for BERT may not sound like much, but keep in mind the model was already highly tuned before adding graphs. Graphs do impose some restrictions. Like I said earlier, the graphed workload must be static. It also must be runnable without needing midstream CPU communication. In practice, this typically means no dynamic shapes or control flow, no syncs, and no essential CPU logic, because the graph will ignore it. So how can you use graphs in PyTorch? There are three user-facing pieces: CUDA Graph, a primitive graph wrapper; Graph, a straightforward context manager that captures work in its context; and Make Graphed Callables, a gadget that turns a callable, a module or function, into a graphed version. If your whole network is capturable, you should use the Graph Context Manager to capture and replay an entire iteration. Here's how that works. First, run a few warm-up iterations to keep spurious, lazy initialization work out of the graph. Then, make some placeholder inputs to use for capture. Create a CUDA graph to hold the graph, then run a dummy iteration under the context to capture the work. Replays typically act on the same memory every time, so the graph will read its input data from the placeholder inputs used in capture. To compute on new data each iteration, first copy that data into the placeholders. And then replay, which runs the whole iteration's GPU work in one call. Params are updated and the latest loss value is written to the placeholder output, capture_loss. Here's a script where a whole network capture is impossible due to a CPU sync and dynamic control flow. In this case, we can use make graphed callables to capture just the capture safe parts. Begin by creating dummy inputs for each callable you want to capture. Then apply make graphed callables to each part you want to capture. Unlike the graph context manager, make graphed callables does not need manual workload warmup. Now just run the network as usual with the graphed callables dropped in. Each callable's forward pass runs as a graph. Note that unlike the graph context, You don't need to manually copy new data to placeholder inputs. Graph callables backward passes will also run as graphs. Make graph callables has some convenience features, but its replays run less efficiently than full network replays. Best practice is to use the graph context manager for full iteration capture when you can, and make graph callables when you must. The graphs API works with native AMP and native DDP. See the documentation for minor gotchas. Graphs should also be composable with JIT. You should be able to JIT a model, warm it up, and then graph it, although only with the NVFuser backend, and generally I'd regard JIT interoperation as experimental. If you've heard enough to consider CUDA graphs, the documentation is much better than this talk's brief summary, so take a look and feel free to file an issue if anything is unclear. Thank you for listening and enjoy the rest of the conference.